Hi, my name is Kaitlyn Lawrence. I'm a gardener here at Scott Arboretum at Swarthmore College. And today we are going to be looking at mid-September blooms. Welcome to the upper biostream. Right now I'm going to be showing you Vernonia gigantea. It's also called tall ironweed. This is a really cool plant because it's, you know, huge as per the species name gigantea. But this is a perennial plant that's native to the eastern United States. It's native to it's hardy to zones 5 through 8. And it's a really cool plant because it will grow almost anywhere. It actually does have the tendency to be a little bit weedy, but Vernonia will grow in prairies, meadows, rain gardens like we have here at the biostream. It's just a really good hardy plant for a lot of different places in the garden. It does grow 8 to 10 feet tall, as you can see. So I like to keep it a little bit farther back in the garden space so that it's, you know, not overtaking an edge. And so it has some other plants that it can stand up on, so it can kind of lean on and, you know, make sure it's standing up straight. But it's a really beautiful plant because it has these really cool purple flower clusters that'll bloom from now into the fall season. And it has these really cool lanceolate leaves. And it's, you know, just this really pretty plant that adds a little bit of seasonality to this area specifically. And we have it in the biostream because it's a really good rain garden plant. And here we have sort of a stormwater basin, so it is tolerant to flooding events, and it's also just great for pollinators. We like this area to be a native, you know, pollinator central, and it's just, you know, one of those plants that I love anywhere. The only thing is it does hybridize with other native species, so it can be a little bit hard to identify. And like I said before, it does spread really easily. It spreads both by rhizomes and by seeds. So what you can do to kind of control it in a garden space is when it starts to go to seed like this, you can cut the flower heads off. It's a little hard because it's so tall. So what we do here is we just rip up any new rogue seedlings we see. But yeah, overall, like I said, really love this plant. It's really good for these kind of naturalized setting gardens. And yeah, that's my Vernonia gigantea. Here we have Ceratostigma plumbaginoides, also known as plumbago. This is a perennial ground cover that's native to Western China, and it's hardy to zones 5 through 9. This is a really cool low growing ground cover with these deep blue to indigo flowers that are very similar to woodland phlox. This ground cover spreads by rhizomes, so it, you know, will readily become aggressive in the optimal environments. Here, we're lucky that we have such a big space like McGill Walk to kind of spread throughout and kind of go crazy. And it's really good in this spot specifically because other parts of the year we have daffodils and lycoris come up, but this will kind of take over right as both of those are pooping out and there's really not of seasonal interest here. So it's just a really great kind of filler plant for this area. And like I said, it adds some color to an otherwise pretty green space, and it is really good as an edge plant too. Another great feature of this plant is that once the flowers start to go out of bloom, it does have this really great bronzy color on the leaves. So even though it might just be a green leafy ground cover, as the season goes on, the bronze color continues to add this kind of seasonal interest to this area. So we're here at Pearson Hall and we're going to talk about Caryopteris planidensis blue mist. This is a perennial shrub that is hardy to zones 5 through 8. We're in the kind of 7 zones, and because of that, the roots are hardy to zones 5, but these kind of upper stems where the flowers are not hardy to zones 5. Because of that, we do a hard prune every year, every winter, on this shrub. This is because the flowers will form on new growth. So when we prune it back every, I would say February, we're kind of encouraging more flowers and more new growth so that we kind of get this huge hedge-like look. And the flowers are these kind of powdery blue clusters that form on these intensely fragrant stems. They're these beautiful, cool-toned green flowers and leaves, excuse me. And these shrubs are just really good as an informal hedge, kind of like how we have it here. I've also seen them in perennial borders. But I just love them here, one, because they're obviously a great pollinator plant. There's bumblebees everywhere around me right now. But I also just like, in this specific setting, they have these kind of droopy stems that kind of flow over the wall and kind of add interest to what would be an otherwise pretty lacking area. On the other side, we have this kind of hedge that really encloses the space of Pearson Terrace so that people, when they're sitting on these benches, can, you know, enjoy the flowers on the Caryopteris, but also feel like they're in kind of like a room per se. Here at the Nason Garden, we have Abelia grandiflora Canyon Creek. This is a cross between Abelia chinensis and Abelia uniflora. This is an evergreen shrub that's in the honeysuckle family. And just like other honeysuckles, it is intensely fragrant. This shrub is hardy to zones 5 through 9, but in zones 8 through 9, it can grow up to 6 feet tall. In some of the colder climates though, it does tend to be a little bit shorter. This shrub will do great in a variety of soils as long as they're well-draining soils. And it's also great in full sun to part shade. These shrubs are really cool because they have a sort of rounded habit, but it's made by these multi-stemmed canes that kind of grow in these long arching patterns that kind of form this really kind of funky looking shrub shape. But I think they're really cool in informal hedges. And I like them how they are here, where they're kind of along a pathway, because one thing about Abelia grandiflora is that these flowers smell amazing. I love when they are along a pathway, so when people are walking to and from, they can kind of get a whiff and they're like, ooh, what's that? And it's this really great shrub. And they come in, Abelias come in a bunch of different colors, but this specific cultivar has these white tinged pinky kind of flowers that form on these clusters on the end of these stems. And one thing I like about flowers that are like this is that a few can fall off, but since there's still a few that are on, it still looks pretty uniform, and it doesn't look how, you know, some other shrubs look where some fall off and they look kind of scraggly. I think Abelia kind of holds its bloom for a pretty long time. And I, like I said, I just think they make a really good informal hedge. I think they're great on pathways. And I think they're just a good evergreen shrub to keep in your garden because they, you know, kind of keep the party going throughout the season. These will go from May through September. I've seen some go a little bit longer into October. But yeah, they're a really good shrub that kind of adds, you know, that fifth smell of this, that fifth sense of smell to a garden, but also has a really fun form and shape to it. We're still here at the Nason Garden, and we're going to talk about Rudbeckia subtomentosa Henry Eilers. This is a perennial plant that is hardy from zones 4 through 8. It is this really cool plant that does well in a lot of different soil settings. It's it likes full sun, and it can handle hot and humid summers as well as a little bit of drought. I really like it because it has these really interesting thin petals. So it's a little bit different than the regular Rudbeckia you would see that has like a regular kind of flower petal. These petals are almost tube shaped. And I really just think it elevates the garden a little bit, sets it apart from, you know, a classic garden. But it also overall is just a really great garden plant for prairies, meadows, even cut flower gardens because of how interesting this flower is. The specific epithet, or the species name, I'm sorry, subtomentosa, means downy under or under downy. So that is for the kind of like scratchy under parts of the leaves. And that kind of helps it become a little bit more deer resistant, because deer don't really like to eat leaves that are a little bit scratchy or a little bit hairy. So I really like it in that sense, that it helps kind of repel any kind of pests or herbivory from deer or even sometimes rabbits. And the cultivar name, Henry Eilers, is for the nurseryman that's from Illinois that discovered the species. And yeah, overall, I think it's a really interesting plant. I think, again, it really sets itself apart from other Rudbeckia species. And it's honestly one of my favorite garden plants that you could have in your garden because of how pretty it is. And it's a great pollinator plant like most other Rudbeckia species are. This is the Gordlinia grandiflora. This is an evergreen, semi-evergreen shrub that is hardy from zone 7 to 9. It is a cross between the Gordonia lazianthus and the Franklinia latimaha. It's this really cool, can be a multi-stem shrub or a small tree that has these really beautiful camellia-like flowers. So you'll get 4 to 5 white petals that cup this really vibrant gold middle center. And you get these really gorgeous green lanceolate leaves. This is a really amazing plant for me. I really love this tree because it's a little bit fragrant, but it's just really showy. And it's a little bit, it's not too different in the landscape where it's almost tropical in a mostly deciduous temperate forest garden, but it still has this kind of different look to it than any other tree. Because the flowers are similar to camellias, they are also really great pollinator plants. They attract bees, butterflies, kind of anything that, you know, is also attracted to camellias. They're a little bit finicky with their sun and light requirements. They enjoy morning sun and afternoon shade, so I would keep them away from that, you know, hot afternoon sun. So we're here at the Teresa Lang Garden of Fragrance, and we are going to talk about marigolds. They're also known as Calendula officinalis. This is the Lady Godiva pot marigold variety. These are an annual that are hardy to zones 2 to 11, so they're kind of, you know, good for any kind of garden. I know them because growing up, my grandpa used to plant these all around his cucumber and tomato beds. He told me this was because they are good at repelling rabbits and groundhogs away from his vegetable plants. And, you know, I'm not going to say he's right, but I'm going to say I've never seen a rabbit in his garden beds. So I do think because they are pretty fragrant, they do are a little bit offsetting to rabbits and groundhogs. So they're a really great vegetable garden companion plant. Historically, calendula is used in salves to treat minor cuts, scrapes, or burns. That's because calendula oil is said to be antifungal, anti-inflammatory, and antibacterial in properties. They are also the national symbol for the Dias de los Muertos, or the Day of the Dead festival in South America. They are used in floral arches, wreaths, and garlands that accompany ofrendas or altars. These flowers are thought to attract the souls of the dead to the altars that were prepared for them. And if you would like to know more about Dias de los Muertos or know more about calendula as a flower, I would definitely encourage you to look into our Gardens and Tonics series later in October. We will have a series all about this type of stuff, and it's definitely something to look forward to on our website. So this is Solidago flexicaulis. This is a herbaceous perennial that we have here at the West Circle Garden. It's hardy through zones 3 through 8, and it's called the zigzag solidago because sometimes these stems will grow in a zigzag shape. Unfortunately, these ones are not. It does kind of, it sometimes happens, sometimes doesn't. But these flowers are really cool because they bloom July through September, and they are just a really cool, dainty version of a solidago. Most other solidagos that you'll see elsewhere are kind of in these large clumps, But these are just a little bit more airy, and I think they add a little bit more kind of like a yellow mist to a natural garden like this. And they do really do well in these natural gardens because they spread by seeds and they spread by rhizomes. So similar to that Vernonia that we talked about before, they can be a little bit aggressive in a garden space. So if you want to keep this in kind of a clump, you're going to have to do a lot of hand pulling, maybe cutting off a few flower stems before they go to seed. But other than that, they're a really great pollinator plant. Bees, butterflies, anything under the sun will pollinate these. Thank you so much for joining in today. Feel free to join us in person or visit us in person. We are open 365 days a year, dawn to dusk, and we hope you have a great day.